At this time, let's give a warm welcome to our friend, a board member of the SCLC, the vice chair of PepsiCo. And he invited, he invented the hot flaming Cheetos. This is the man. Give him a big round of applause.
Thank you. It's a, it really is a great honor and privilege to be here. And I'm going to take a few minutes just to kind of share a little bit about my story so that you can know who I am, because I take these things seriously. So we're family now, right? And how does family talk to each other? You know, so I'm not here to do any commercials. You know, I'm not going to talk about Pepsi too much. But it's a little warming. That tastes good, but don't be rushing. You know, I'm going to talk a little bit about civil rights, and I've never had any idea, nor did I ever have a dream, that I would be standing alongside men and women of this caliber, people who have a heart for people, people that walk with, you know, my hero, Dr. King. You know, we never met him, but we knew who he was. Because while he was out here doing his thing, he was speaking for everyone in the country who were living under those conditions. You know, and we're talking about unity. You know, every presidential candidate talking about, you know, I can bring unity. And I'm just looking at him like, God help us all if the truth is going to bring unity. And again, I don't mean to be disrespectful, but bringing unity is something difficult. It's got to be in your heart.
Yes.
You've got to know where people came from. The number one killer in this country isn't from a badge, it's from poverty. That's what I'm talking about. Somebody get killed because they had a broken taillight. You and I will never experience that. You and I will always pay for our tags because poverty isn't an issue for us. I come from poverty. And I had those issues. I remember getting pulled over. You don't have any tags. I got a ticket. If I couldn't buy the tags, why are you going to give me a ticket? I can't pay the ticket. You have no insurance, so we're going to impound your car. If I can't buy insurance, why are you going to impound? That's what happens to people in poverty. See, so many people don't ever experience what you and I have experienced. They've never been hungry. They've never had to fight in their life. Well, it's a great honor to be here. I'm going to do three things real quickly. How much time do I have?
30 minutes.
30 minutes? Okay, I'll tell you guys when to start the clock, okay? Three things I want to do. First thing is, I want to inspire you. And if you look up the word inspire, it simply means to breathe life into someone. Aren't you glad when somebody comes in and breathes life into you? That one word, that one smile, that one handshake, it makes a difference for that one day. The second thing that I'd like to do is I'd like to encourage you. And this is what I love to tell young people. What is to encourage them? It means to take courage and plant it in their deepest being. They're never the same again. What is it to discourage someone? It's to go into their deepest being and remove the courage that they're never the same again. Stay away from people who discourage you. Hang out with people who encourage you. The last thing that I'd like to do is I want to remind you of who you are and the value that you bring. Sometimes we forget who we are. Sometimes people want to say, well, what is your title? I don't need a title.
Come on.
I know who I am. Sometimes we've got to, somebody once said, you know, Richard, you're so full of yourself. You know what I said? I am, you should be too. So I'm going to take you back. I'm going to take my jacket off.
Sure, sure, please.
So I'm
going to
take you back to 1968.
into the 60s.
Yeah. Some of you weren't there, some of you were there, some of you were just getting born. I was a little child. I'm going to move around a lot, so let me know if you can still hear me. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, so let's go back to where I come from. I come from a small town in Southern California. Oh, I can take it with me. Yeah, technology.
Thank you, brother. Appreciate that. So let me take you back to a place where I come from. I was born in a labor camp. My grandpa picked grapes, my dad picked grapes, and what do you think I did? We picked grapes. We lived in a one room, it wasn't even an apartment, just a one room, cinder block. The kitchens were across the hallway. It was like a community kitchen. They had the restaurant stoves. Everybody had their own refrigerator. It was mine, Montanez, Martinez, Sanchez. And the bathrooms and the showers were like the high school. It was, you know, down in Southern California, a small town called Guasti, California. It's actually where Ontario International Airport's at. That used to be my town. It's pretty much gone now. Not too much of the history has been kept. So, 1960-something, here's what happened. Mom is getting her oldest son ready for school. Second grade, it's me. She's helping me get dressed, and I'm crying. And Mama says, Chion, ¿por qué lloras? Cry baby, why are you crying? Porque no quiero ir a esa escuela. Because I don't want to go to that school. ¿Por qué no, mijo? Why not, son? Porque todos hablan inglés. Because everybody speaks English. See, that's when they were busing kids to different schools. So this is what I'd like to say. I grew up during the civil rights movement of the 60s. I wasn't old enough to have an impact on the movement, but I was old enough that the movement had an impact on me. But here's what happened. Where's the law, Vito? You gotta go to school. I'm like, I don't wanna go to the all-white school. I don't speak English. Somebody said, you still can't speak English. It's not that I can't speak English. I'm not in my own dictionary. So, my uncle takes me, and there was about 10 of us who were picked from our school to ride the bus across town. So my uncle takes us to the corner. This is a true story. And there we are, like, man, I'm telling my deal, I don't want to go to this school. He's like, would you stop it now? You got to go. There's 10 of us there. So here comes the yellow bus, dirt road. Here comes the yellow bus. There goes the yellow bus. They didn't stop for us. You should have seen 10 little kids like, oh, we don't have to go to school. Maybe it's a Latino holiday. And then you ever heard that? Have you ever heard a car backfire? Well, we heard this backfire. We turned around. The ugliest green bus you could ever imagine was pulling up. I'm looking like this. First of all, I don't want to go to the school. Second, I'm telling my tío, my uncle, why can't I ride the yellow bus? I'm going to get on that ugly green thing. This is the bus they sent for you. You know, it wasn't until I was an adult and it clicked up. You know how sometimes things happen to remind you? I've always said this. Sometimes to find your future, you got to go to your past. So one day it just clicked on me. Out of nowhere. I wasn't even thinking about it. Just like, they sent that green bus for one reason. They were going to put 10 Latino kids on that green bus, the ugliest green bus, parades across town to show everybody in that community, guess what? This group isn't good enough to ride the yellow bus like the average normal kids. We're going to put them on this bus to show everyone. And guess what happened to this little boy?
Yeah.
I wasn't good enough to get on that yellow bus. So that's how I felt as a little boy. So we get to school. Remember, there's no bilingual classes. You want your license, you better speak English. There's nobody to help me. We were on our own. Teacher could care less. So there we were. ¿Qué? ¿Qué? What? What'd she say? Jose, you know what her say? No entiendo, Ricardo. I don't know. But, oh, wow. But there's one sound. It's an international sound. Every kid knows that sound because it's a bilingual sound. Yeah. It speaks in the sound that you understand. It was the reset bell. I didn't need an interpreter. I knew what it was. You know, that was a great relief for us. So we went, we sat down, it was 10 of us. Use your imagination. The 10 of us sat together. I don't remember if there was 30 kids or 300 kids. I just remember we were sitting there, grouped together. And I pulled out my lunch, ready to take a bite. Just like this, moments stopped. Time stopped. Everybody was staring at me. I grabbed my lunch and I put it back in the bag. Why do you think I put it back in the bag? Any idea? Because it was a burrito. You gotta remember, this was 1963. The world hadn't seen a burrito yet. Contrary to popular belief, Taco Bell didn't introduce the burrito to the world. Me and my mom did. The truth, I was embarrassed. I was embarrassed of this color. I was embarrassed because I spoke Spanish. And I was embarrassed because I was eating burritos. I was embarrassed because I rode on a green bus. So I go home. And my mom's washing, you know, my mom had 12 kids and she was always washing dishes. So there she was. She was washing dishes and I walked in and I started yelling at her. You know, you don't yell at your mom, right? I mean, but I did. And I said this. I said, Mama, ask me un bologna sandwich con un cupcake como los otros. Mama, make me a bologna sandwich and a cupcake like the other kid. Because I don't want to be different. I want to fit in. I want to be like Johnny. I want to be like Robert. I want to be like Mary. I don't want to be like Ricardo and Jose. My mom, being a marketing genius that she is. You know, I said this, and I even put a little bit in my book. Matter of fact, I'm selling my book outside for $15, and I give the money away I buy shoes, and I feed hundreds of thousands of kids. Every year, I buy 50,000 pairs of shoes, and I go into the hoods, into the bodies, and I give them away to kids in need. I spent about $1 million out of my own money. Somebody say, why do you do that? Because I can! Mama said, marketing gene, I said this, ladies, this is for you. Guys, this isn't for you. Ladies, this is for you. Because of my grandma, my mom, and my wife, I found out that when God created women, he was showing up. The leadership of a woman is so special. It is so different. Nothing can take a woman down.
Right.
See, I don't know if Hillary's going to be president or not. I'm not telling you who to go vote for. Believe me, I'm not. But I know this for a fact. If we have a woman leading this country, I don't know what will happen, but two things I do know will happen. We will all have a roof over our head and food on the table. That's what a woman does. So she said, that was when she said, no, Mijo, this is who you are. So the next day, she made me two burritos. And she said, this one is for you, and this one is to try to make a friend. So Wednesday was my burrito nightmare. Thursday, I shared a burrito with a friend. Friday, I was selling burritos for 25 cents a piece. In the third grade as a little boy who knew nothing, I began to realize, I began to look at my color and how I spoke, and I began to realize that maybe, just maybe, there's something special about being different.
Yeah.
Like that. I like that.
I finally realized as a little boy.
Yeah. What happened?
I finally realized as a little boy that as much as I wanted to fit in, I wasn't created to fit in. I was created to stand out. To fit it. great. And if you feel you need somebody's permission to become great, well, guess what? I'm here today. You have my permission to become great.
I like
this. This is what our young people need to know.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Sweetheart, as hard as you try, you weren't created to fit in. Young man, you were created to stand out, live your life. So I began to figure that out as a little boy. There was no education where we were at. You know, to tell you the truth, I didn't want to school. I'm not going to tell you what grade I was school, but I teach leadership and MBA classes at universities across the country. I don't have a high school diploma. I couldn't read. That's why I said, you know, somebody said, you misspelled that. I said, no, I needed to get my dictionary. Why? I'm serious. Why? Because we let somebody by the name that we've never met, Webster, create words that you and I, why can't we create our own words?
That's right.
I'm serious. I'm not kidding. So I finally realized that maybe, even though my father was not a dreamer, my grandfather was not a dreamer. They didn't tell us you can be anything that you want. Not that they didn't love us. Their dream is there going to be enough food for us today. It wasn't about going to a college. It wasn't about doing all this stuff. And again, I remember, we're still in the 60s, okay? I'll tell you when we go to the 70s, 80s, 90s. We're still in the 60s. About a week goes by now. The teacher says, today, class, we're going to talk about our dreams. So, what do you want to be? Mary, what do you want to be? Mary's going to be a veterinarian. Bobby, what are you going to be, Bobby? I'll be an astronaut. Roger, I always loved that name, Roger. I wanted that. I always wanted that name, Roger. I don't want that name, Roger, anymore, but he's a little boy. Roger just stood out. Roger, what are you going to be? You're going to be an astronaut, too. Jackie, a pilot, a doctor. She's asked everybody in her boat with that little dark kid in the back. She goes, well, I guess I gotta ask Ricardo. You know that I was born to Ricardo, but somewhere in the process I became Richard. I thought I'd go back to Ricardo, because I'm not your Richard, but instead of Ricardo, my birthday. What the heck happened? She says, Ricardo, what's your dream? What are you gonna be when you grow up? I'm just like, barely understanding, like, huh? I don't know. I don't have a dream. I don't know. So, she says, well, go home and find out. So what do? I go to my inspiration. I go to the first woman that I fell in love with, my mom. There she is washing dishes again. I don't even turn around. You know, mom, I don't even need to turn around to talk to you, right? But you know she's talking. So I said it again. I said, Mama, teacher asked me a question today. She said, what am I going to be? What's my dream, Mama? And turn around, she just said, Mexican, deal with it. I remember I went back to school the next day, and I said, teacher, I know my dream, I know what I'm going to be when I grow up. Teacher's like, okay, what is it? Mama said, I'm going to be Mexican, deal with it. So one day, the school bus pulls up, and the work truck pulls up, where all the men jumped in the back to go into the field. The fields were just a couple blocks away. And I had my lunch, looked at the school wasn't doing anything for me. I wasn't whining. I couldn't understand. You know what I found out? This is what I love to tell people. We need to tell young people, guess what? I'm probably the most uneducated, brilliant person you will ever meet.
Go ahead.
So they pull up. Instead of getting on the bus, I get on the work truck as a little boy with my dad and grandpa. I don't think they looked at me like, yo, man. That's all we knew. We didn't know outsider. They didn't know that was a bad thing. They thought to them, in our culture, it was like, you know, we've since changed that, but again, that's why I'm going back to Dr. King. He started this revolution that we're talking about. And it's still continuing. So I'm saying it's impacted me more than you will ever know what Dr. King has done for my life, for my family's life. You will never know. I've always said this, you don't know where we've been, you don't know where we come from, and you don't know who we are. I ain't got time to explain it. I just know who I am. That's the type of pride you and I should have.
That's right. That's right.
Where's your business card? It's too big for me to carry. I got on the truck, I went to work. Hard work. 100 degrees, well, because you're on the sand, it's 120 degrees. Picking grape. And so you pick the grape that you try to determine the highest, when the weather's going to hit its highest. Because you don't want it too hot because it makes it too sweet. It doesn't stay long. This is for making wine. This wasn't great to eat. So you have to know, like, God, we've got to hit it today. We've got to pick everything before 1 o'clock because that's when it's going to be 115 degrees. And so we do that. Then one day, I've always said, look, all you need is one revelation that will lead to a revolution in your life. What is a revelation? Something that was always there but been revealed to you. In other words, this cell phone is right here. You didn't know it's here, but I'm going to reveal it to you. Things that have been unveiled, that's a revelation. So I got my first revelation in the third grade. Now we're going into the 70s. My neighbor said, hey, they're hiring at Frito-Lay. And I remember that feeling I had. Frito-Lay. Just think, if I could get a job at Frito-Lay, I could change the legacy of the Montanez family. I could take my family from the field to the factories. I can get married because I'll have benefits and insurance. I can propose to my wife, my second love. So my neighbor said, yeah, just go get it. So I get the application. This is the truth. I couldn't read or write. I wrote a book. I've had lunch and dinner with every U.S. president for the last 25 years. I had dinner with President Obama 6 months ago. I spoke to the United Nations, 2003, thousands of ambassadors. Filling out my application. I take it to my wife, who's my girlfriend at the time, and she filled it out for me. You know, I've carried this lie for almost 40 years. I want to confess it. Because when the HR manager, they won't call the HR, they'll call something else, saw that, he said, man, you got great handwriting. I stole my wife's glory. I'm confessing that. And he says, you're hired. Guess what I was? A janitor. You know what I thank God for, though, in 1976 that I got hired? I thank God for one thing. Because I was hired on the spot. You know what that one thing was? They didn't do background checks in 1976. Remember when Arnold Schwarzenegger was governor in California? I didn't vote for him. I realized that California was crazy. I woke up in a pit like, he really won. Oh my God. Gary. I got a phone call from him. Literally did. He said, Richard, I heard that you big on economic development. I know what you do with the community. I'd like for you to sit on one of my boards. It's an official government appointment. I said, well, first of all, I didn't vote for you. Second, I'm not leaving Pepsi. He said, it's okay, you didn't vote for me. No, you don't have to leave. So I thought about it, and this is what I thought, 300,000 employees at the time, and not one of them has an official government appointment. So I'm like, yeah, let's do that. So he says, okay, consider it done. I'm going to put you in charge with my secretary appointment, whatever they're called. So the guy faxes the application to my office. So we sit down. He's on, conference call. I'm sitting on my desk. The first question says, this is crazy, says this. Have you or anyone in your family ever done anything that would embarrass the governor of California? I'm like, I'm Mexican! Everybody's got that one uncle. Even you guys have that one uncle. If you say you don't have that one uncle, you're probably that one uncle! So we get through it. So the last part he said, welcome all we got to do is a background check. Background check? Well, how far back do you go? So we got it. I got the job. I ran home, told my father and my grandfather. This is what my grandfather said. This is what I've earned up to today. This is my value. This is what I live. My grandfather said, son, mijo, when you mop that floor, you make sure that it shines and people will know that a Montanez mopped it. My father said, son, when you mop that floor, you listen to your grandfather. You make sure that it shines, that people will know that a Montanez mopped it. You know that I took that on? Somebody said, oh, you're just a janitor? You know what, ladies and gentlemen? There's no such thing as just a janitor. When you believe in your heart that you're going to be the best, there's no such thing. There's no such thing as just a waiter. There's no such thing as just a bus driver. When you believe in your, and I said to myself, I'm going to be the best janitor in the history of Frito-Lay. Guess what I became? I became the best janitor in the history of Frito-Lay. So I finally realized, this is what our young people need to know. I finally realized, as much as I love PepsiCo, as much as I love Frito-Lay, this company, it isn't about them. It's about my last name. It's about my legacy. It's about what Dr. King left. Had he not had who he was, his legacy wouldn't be alive today. It was about what he did. You see, many times people say, we need to get things straight. Many times people say, that Dr. King left a legacy. That's incorrect. He didn't leave a legacy. He gave a legacy. There's a difference. So I began to mop the floors. You know, and people say you get promoted by who you know. Again, that's not true either. You get promoted by who knows you. You can say you know the president all you want, but if he doesn't know you, it doesn't matter. You need to get known. But our young people need to know. I mean, people have said, Mr. Montanez, if I get that position, I will work my hardest for you. So you're not working your hardest for me now? Mr. Montanez, if you just give me that raise, I'll give you everything I have. You're not giving me everything you have now? You know, I'm old school, okay? It's hard to be new school when you're old school. Because one day I remember, you know, 25 years ago, I told my boss, hey, I had a great year. And he looked at me like, okay, what are we paying for? We pay you to have a great year. Show me something that you did that I didn't pay you to do. That's when you stand out. I get paid to do this, but look, I brought this too. Those are outstanding results when you're paid to do a good job. Don't ever tell your manager, I did a good job. So you get paid. Tell your manager, I did something that nobody else could do. What is it? I brought you my last name. That's my legacy. You do that, nothing will ever stop you. So I get hired, and here comes that revelation. The CEO at the time sent out a message on video, but that was the technology of the day. He said, I want everybody to act like an owner. Shut all the plants down. I want everybody to act like an owner. Then I'm sitting there as a janitor. I grabbed it. Didn't you hear what he said? He said, we can all act like owners. We're nobodies. I'm a janitor. I'm not going to do nobody. Is he serious? So I went to work. I went to a salesman. And I told the salesman, can I go with you on my day out? I'll load the truck. And, you know, you tell a salesman, free labor. What do they say? Show up. You can come on your vacation if you want. So I went with him to the store because I was a janitor. I didn't know our business. And I saw how we put the chips on the rack. And I was looking for something. All you need is one revelation. It'll lead to a revolution. So I turned around. I saw a revelation. And I'm looking at him and like, you don't see that, huh, do you? You know what I saw? I saw a rack of spices. And I thought, and I looked at our rack. When I started with PepsiCo, with Frito-Lay, it was Lay's regular, Lay's barbecue, Dorito regular and Dorito taco. Ruffles regular. What you see out there that has any spice, that is my signature. Here's what happened. Here's what happened. Oh, what if we start making product that has spices for you and I?
Come on, man.
You and I come from the same place. fried. I love my food fried. You love it hot. I love it hot. You like Kool-Aid. I like Kool-Aid. There's no difference, man. Some of you are, you know, you're lighter than me. We are family.
We are.
We come from the same place. I said this, man. Sometimes people will say, you know, what do you think God looks like? Open the Bible. It tells you right there. Bronze.
Curly, curly hair.
Where does he come from? Look right there. It comes from this area. And I personally believe that your community is blessed beyond measures. You're the smartest. You're the fastest. You're the strongest. You're passionate. You can't match it. You're probably the closest humanity as an individual can get to what God really looks like.
Oh, yeah.
I'm serious. You're a preacher? Nobody can preach like you guys. That's why I hang out with you guys. Let it rub off. I don't care, man. I don't want to be like that. I want what you have. I want that passion. That's what's kept me alive. That's my education, because I had none. So I'm thinking, how can I create something? What is it? In my neighborhood, where I used to live, in my neighborhood, we have what is called the elote man. A street vendor. Looks like an ice cream truck. And he sells corn on a cob on a stick, and he puts chili, you've seen that, right? Chili and all that, whatever you want. He's got in that little thing, a dollar pop. You shoot him a whistle, hey, bring me two, because my oldest son is, you know, the old porch, the old concrete porch, you know, no brick, you know, old concrete porch, original porch. Sitting there, and bring me two. He's like, con todo, with everything, well, of course, con todo, everything. I'm a little more chile. So what do you need for a revolution? One revelation. So I'm eating this corn, yes, and I'm thinking, and I'm even praying, God, open my eyes. Let me see the things that other people can't see. Ain't nobody else going to help me. Welfare's not going to help. I've been on welfare food stamp. I've been homeless. I used to sleep in a park. No one came to help me.
Come on.
Brothers and sisters, there ain't nobody coming to help you.
Yeah.
We're going to help ourselves. We will never achieve social equality until we achieve economic equality. They'll stop killing us when we have money. Sad is the truth, but when we got money in our pockets, we won't have to worry about that. But that's the truth. Ain't nobody coming to help me. Nobody coming to help. We got to do it ourselves. We're going to group together. The doctor and I, we're going to do such great things with this board. It's going to revolutionize our country. We're not going to wait for some senator or governor to come and say, we're going to fix this party. You come to ourselves.
Yeah.
And don't tell me how you spend taxpayer money. Tell me how you spend your money. Let me see your wallet. I know what you do with my money. Well, let me see. Here's my wallet. Look where I gave. Let me see where you gave. Taxpayer tax. Give him another award. So I realized, here was that revelation. I was taking a bite. That looks just like a Cheeto. What if I put chili on a Cheeto? Woo! Ridiculous idea. But I said this. Many times greatness will come in a ridiculous form. In order for you to achieve your greatness, are you willing to look ridiculous?
Yes.
So I thought about it. I told my wife, hey, let's make up our own chili. So I went to the plant. I got some with no seasoning on it. We did it. She took some to her work. I took some to my work. And guess what everybody said? They loved it.
Go ahead.
So I said, okay, my wife, you know, she's the leader in the house. You know, she's the smart one. She's the beautiful handwriting. She's that type of woman that you would always say, ain't nobody better than you, Richard.
Come on.
Right. You're a little mad at us all. Go get it done. See, I got her number now. When she wants, you know, she says like, you know, I'm thankful that I live in a house that I can't maintain. So I have a handyman. She said, hire me a handyman. You know, and she'd be like, you know what? You can fix all this. You know what, Richard? You can do all this stuff. There ain't nobody better than you. But I know you're so busy, just bring me a handyman. So I'm like, handyman, you work for her for the next couple of months. She knows how to do it. So she says, we'll call the CEO. And this is in the 70s. You know, it's two of our great leaders from Pepsi, man. These two of my very good friends. Wave your hand up here, man. These guys. Skip here, I'm home from my California days. Actually, Skip helped me a lot. He runs the state for Pepsi, and a great man. Get his business card because he's got a big heart. And my other buddy Lamont runs this. You got the whole country, right? They got the whole country for food service. So Skip runs the state for Pepsi. He runs the country for food service Pepsi. I run the country for everything. CEO. No, in the noise is CEO. No, I'm the CEO. Chief Encouragement Officer. Plant manager was in Texas, you just go, so right there, put chief executive of PepsiCo, his number. So I went into where all the admins were at, the secretaries, and I said, hey, can I use the phone? And she's like, no, you know this is just for company, you can't use it for personal time. This is the 70s. I said, no, I want to call the CEO. She's like, well, use mine. Why did her attitude change so quick? Because she ain't never seen anybody fired on the spot. So I called the CEO, his admin. She's retired, she's my good friend of mine. She's very, very successful. Her husband owned one of the big toy companies, not Pokemon, but you know, one of those companies. So she's, and I believe because she did the right things, that the right things did her. So she said, hello, this is, who is it? I said, Richard Montanez. She said, what country do you run? Because I know the president of Frito-Lay in America, that's not you. But no, I work in America. I work in the United States. She said, oh, okay, you're the president of California? I said, no, I work in one of the plants. She said, oh, you're the vice president of operations. I said, no, I work inside the plant. She said, oh, you're the plant director? I said, no, I work inside. She said, oh, you're the plant manager. I said, no. She goes, well, what are you? I go, I'm the janitor. Never been done. I say that I've changed corporate America because of that one. You see, you never know the wave that you leave behind.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
By that one statement that you did, The things that other people will enjoy. Maybe you'll never get the credit, but we don't do it for the credit, right?
No, sir.
So she said, hang on. See you now. So he gets on, I spend 10 minutes with him. I'm telling him, hey, I got this idea. We can target, you know, Latinos, we can target African Americans, we can target Asians because they all like hot spices. And he's like, that's fantastic. I'll be there in 2 weeks. Hung up the phone. The janitor did it. But I've always said this. Listen to me, people. We need to teach our young. I want to deal with more young people in here.
Right.
This is what our young people need to hear. I teach this to my grandkids. My grandkids are militant in a good way. Skip, one time I took my grandson and we went to a store and there was a Coke display. He goes, Grandpa, look. I'm like, no! You're kicking the Coke. No. Is that what I touch you?
That was a good way.
So, listen to me. I'm up the phone. I'm on a cloud. I'm floating. But I've always said this. I don't care what room you're in. There's always somebody in that room that's going to try to steal your destiny.
All right.
Your job is to be ready, not rock. I come out as happy as can be. Well, guess what happened? I don't know protocol. I can't even spell the word. The protocol began. The CEO called the president, who called the senior vice president, who called the vice president, who called the little vice president, who called the real little vice president, who called the director, who called the plant manager. Hey, who left the janitor to call the CEO? Who is this Richard Montanez? Prime manager comes, who do you think you are? You realize what you've done? Now I gotta paint the place. I've never even done homework. So I go home to my wife, and the first thing I say, hey, I think I'm going to get fired. And remember, you told me to call him. Typical leadership of a female. Goes into action. Calm down. We're going to go to the library. I'm going to check out a book on how to develop a marketing strategy. So we went to the library, checked out a book many, many years ago. We copied the first five, not chapters, but paragraphs. I remember in those days it was transparencies. So we had to put on transparencies. I bought some almost like Ziploc. They weren't Ziplocs. Kind of like that. It was at a special store. I bought some, you know, some bags, and I made 100 bags. I'm a little bit of an artist. We drew on the bags, and then you know how I sealed it? It's ingenuity. When you're hungry, when you ain't got no other resources other than what you have inside here and up here, that's enough.
Right.
So my wife said, let's just iron. So we ironed the bags. You could not tell. So I went to the local store, bought me a tie for $3.50. This tie isn't $3.50. My neighbor tied it into a knot the night before. So in the morning, I put it on. On my presentation, got the 100 bags, and I'm walking out that door, and my woman is saying, there is nobody better than you.
Right.
You're going to knock their door. They don't know what they're going to see. You go get what belongs to us, Richard, because it is ours.
I'm like, yeah.
Sorry, Mom. I mean, she just knew how to do it. Ladies, the abilities that you have, you already control the world. So I'm there I was. Have you ever done a presentation with transparencies? You know, you didn't agree on that, right? Because it was upside down. I've never done it, but I can hear people like, I lift it up, and then I got it. I was just, hey, I got it. And guess what? Doing. The janitor was presenting to 50 of the most highly qualified leaders of my organization. The chief marketing officer was there. The senior vice president of anything was there. And I was doing it. But isn't there always somebody in your room who will try to steal your destiny? A few years ago, I was teaching an MBA class at a university. Can't tell you the name because I don't think they want everyone to know that one of the professors doesn't have a high school diploma. But the school is kind of on a hill and you can see the water. Give you an idea where it's at. MBA class. About 28 students. Yes. Oh, Mr. Montanez. All of my professors have degrees. I'd like to know where you got your degree. Inside, we're who we are, right? Do you know where we come from? You should figure it out before you start asking questions. So tell me, Mr. Montanez, what university did you go to? University of Cucamonga. Where's that at? Never mind, private school, you couldn't get in. Mr. Montanez, yes. I'll buy that. But all my professors have PhDs. What about you? Oh, I've got a PhD. I've been poor, hungry, and determined.
Yeah,
all right. What if the marketing executive says, well, how much market share are we talking about? First of all, I said questions. I'm like, oh no, we don't have time for questions. And you know, my prime manager friend Richard, he still got time. Oh. What's the question? How much market share are we talking about? Market share? We haven't read that chapter yet. Of course I know what market share is today, but the truth is I have no idea what it was. almost fainted. Have you ever been so scared that you almost fainted? I mean an embarrassment scared. Not a street fight scared. You just made a fool of yourself and everyone's laughing at you. And I finally realized, you know what happened? I was that little boy with the burrito. I was that little boy that had no dream. I was that little boy who wrote on that green. But that's why we gotta tell our kids today that there is nobody better than them. But there was a door like that, ready to run out. I'm just gonna run out. But you know, I had something inside of me that was greater than the fear. Let's go back to the third grade. Sometimes you gotta go back to where your path to find your future.
Right.
So I remember they were having because of Dr. King. People don't know this. What he did for us, the school had to get teachers that were bilingual. So every Tuesday they had two traders, one for the non-Latino, the white kids, and one for the Latinos, where they taught us how to read in English. So every Tuesday, this is the truth. Listen to me, I'm gonna start winding down. Every Tuesday I got into the line that I was told to get into. And one day, guess what I did? You and I have done this. This is what I have to teach our children how to do. Guess what I did one day? Is I broke ranks. And I walked over here and I got in the white line. You should have heard my own. Intention or unintention, they were saying, regardless, you're on the wrong line. This is the line that I told us to get into. You know what? As scared as I was, I looked at them. They were, even my friends right here, little Johnny was like, hey, Richard, that's your line. They didn't know it. We didn't know what diversity was. Discrimination, we were too small. Me and my wife, we've known each other. Somebody said, how long have you been married? My whole life. Her and I used to go trick-or-treating across town to the big houses, because in my hood, there was no candy there. There was no knock on no door. I go across town where the big candies were at. You know what I'm talking about, huh? Out there coming around, people would say, you're not from around here, are you? No. So then they go back where you belong. We were never hurt or upset because we didn't know. See, we just felt that my destiny and your destiny, Judy, is to live on this side of the tracks. Our destiny is to struggle every single day. Forget about your dreams. We didn't know any better. So my friends are calling me. This is what I said. They have cookies inside. I'm going to get us some cookies. Two beautiful blonde blue eyes. Ladies were up there. And I remember I got in the line and I thought, can they tell I'm not white? You know, in the third grade, I looked like this. I had this and my hair automatically. I put my hands in my pocket and I was, tell you the truth, I was scared. I was scared. And I got there. You know what those two white ladies did? They filled my pockets with cookies. What's the moral of that story? Two parts. Why did I get out of that line? Into that line. As scared as I was, something inside me was greater. You know what that was? I was hungry! Hunger is the antidote to fear. When you're hungry to run for that office, to get that degree, to buy that home, to start that business, to run for an office, fear will lead. Second part of that story. What I want, again, our children. There's a cookie that's been baked for all of us. Our job is to get out of that line they told you to get into and get into the cookie line. Get out of the poverty line and get into the prosperity line. The only line you should ever really stand in is the DMV. Every other line is your choice. So as scared as I was, the CEO sitting right there, Al Carrier, who's the CEO today, he's our boss, sitting right there. He wasn't who he is today. He was a young man just, you know, many years ago. So I said, like, so I remembered our rap, you know, we call them gondolas. It's like, how much market shall I? A revelation. I went, huh? This much market share. How ridiculous is that? Well, many times your greatness will come in a ridiculous form. I could hear that. Oh, no, it didn't. Oh, man. Why is everybody just like, the CEO right there, guess what he did? He came on, he just passed away. Became my best friend and my mentor. Stood up and he said, ladies and gentlemen, do you realize that we have the opportunity to go after that much market share? Our boss, Al, stood up, turned to his sales team and said, sales team, do you think we can get that market share? That ridiculous statement made me a legend in this country. I say that humbly. It's really hard to be humble when you're great, isn't it? So he said, put that mop away, you're coming with us.
All right.
This October, I will hit 40 years with this company as an executive. And I've made a fool of myself for 40 years. But I've come to realize I will never fit in. Last story, and I'll end with this. After that, I got a phone call from the CEO. He says, come to New York. Take a commercial to New York because we're going to have dinner at the White House. Are you serious? I've never been on a plane. Yeah, come down. We're going to take the corporate jet from New York to D.C. So I have no luggage. Because we've never, what do you need luggage for? You ain't going nowhere. So my wife, we went to Sears. Have you ever seen that luggage that's this size? And there's 10 inside. Well, she bought that this size. I'm going for 2 days. Like, I make it to New York, JFK, I take a cab to our hangar, and I'm the first one there. The secretary said, the CEO and the board of directors are coming, but they're running late, so they just said, go ahead and get on the plane. You know, the plane's right there, close to Vienna, two pilots, Nothing like you see, unless you're, P. Diddy or one of those guys, it's not like that. It's just convenient. We don't have no big old parties, nothing like that. If you're on a corporate jet, more than likely you're going to work. Well, I didn't know that, so I'm coming, and two pilots looked at me, and they saw that luggage. They're like, sorry, sir, you can't get that. That little boy again. I was that little boy again. Like, oh my God, no, you got to get on. I'm embarrassed. Like, they're going to come right down. The little compartment, in the size of the middle. So they put it on the outside, a couple of kicks. Kick it. It's okay. It's sincere. And you know that when I used to travel, we didn't know it because I've never been on a plane. My wife always made my lunch. This is when planes, used to serve you food, right? But even on that, I'm on a corporate jet. I got food. I shared it with everybody on that plane. So I sit down in the first seat that I see, and I'm so scared. I can see the memos pulling up. Here come the board of directors. And by this, they already knew because Flamin' Hot Cheetos has become $1 billion a year. I've created 15 other products since then. Each product sells over $300 million each. Ain't nobody else has made this kind of money from it. Somebody said, again, you're so full of yourself. I am. You should be too. So here they come. Hi, Richard. Glad you could come. Hi, Richard. They're all with that brown little plum. Look, see, they got, I want a brown little bag that can hang over like them. And here comes the CEO. Hi, Richard. Hey, guys, I'm going to sit in the back. Just like 30 minutes from there to there. We get there. We go to the White House, special dinner, and we have to shake hands and meet the president. And next time I'll tell you how we became friends. And the senior vice president of HR is sitting right across from me. She's looking at me, she just laughs. She goes, Richard, I just love you. I love the way you love life. You just don't care, huh? I'm like, oh, no. No, I do care. Why do I care? Let's start saying, Tommy, what did I do? By this time, she's like, oh, she didn't mean me. I don't know if I know. I go, please just tell me. I said, well, on the way over here, you sat in the SCLC. You know what the first thing I thought? typical Latino, even on the corporate jet, I call shotgun. So we fly back. I sit in the back, of course. Got an American Airlines to go back to LAX. Sat on the window seat. Put my head, I'm going to share some things because we're family. I put my head in the window and I started crying. I said, when will I start acting? I called the other executives. When am I going to fit in? I made a fool of myself. And that little voice is bilingual because it talks into the language that you understand. It said to me, I told you as a little boy, you were never created to fit in. You were created to stand out. You will never fit in. Remember this, Richard, for the rest of your life. It doesn't matter where you sit. What matters is where does your heart sit? What matters is what do you think of yourself?
Yeah.
And you know that to this day, I give it up. I tried looking like, I stopped trying to look like, I did one thing, I got me that brown leather bag. But I stopped trying to talk, I stopped trying to act like I started. But you know what? The things that I've done, none of them have been able to accomplish. None of them. Why? Because I was true to myself. Always with respect. And this is why I'm so honored to be a part of this organization. Because I believe it's the next chapter. I'm militant in the right way. But to have an army like you guys behind the things that, oh my God, come on. Doctors, people that walked with Dr. King, there is nothing stopping us. So here's what I say. Dr. King did one thing, is he gave us his legacy. Here's what he did. Is he changed the laws of America. But he left us some work.
Yes, sir.
What is that? That is to change the heart of America.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.